All right, joining us this Monday morning in the studio is Attorney Dan Fajardo. He's the president of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. Attorney Fajardo, thank you so much for coming to the show.
It's my pleasure.
All right, what does this appointment mean? Less than 2 months to go, she was the nemesis of her predecessor, former Chief Justice Sereno. What appointing her, what message is Malacañang trying to say?
Well, my take on this is that she is a transition Chief Justice, no? And her appointment will in effect solidify the ruling on the co-warranty petition, because that would mean that after the ruling, there finally is a new Chief Justice. Justice Carpio has been acting Chief Justice for some time now, but that is under a, of course, because of a vacancy created by the co-warranty decision. So that the appointment of Chief Justice Terestita Leonardo-De Castro is in effect a validation of the decision.
Okay, that's a very interesting point of view. Yeah. You're saying that President Duterte himself knows and acknowledges that he is appointing a transition Chief Justice. But many might ask, what for? Why not the other two who would have stayed there much longer?
Well, I can only surmise as to what was going on in the mind of the president. In fact, if you were observant of the events the past few days or the last week, it was on Thursday afternoon that the congressmen announced that they would be filing, but that they were at that time filing impeachment complaints against the seven co-warranty justices. Mm-hmm. And right after that, the next day, the very next day, the JBC transmitted the list to the president. Mm-hmm. And the day after that, the president appointed Chief Justice De Castro. So in effect, that would mean that she had, well, if you would think that there was a cooperation among the bodies that effected this appointment, it would seem that he had made up his mind that it would be Justice De Castro in the meantime.
Okay. Now, Attorney, there is no question on Justice Terestita De Castro's qualifications, so to speak.
Yes.
She's one of the most senior, and clearly you can read her past cases, and then everything else makes her qualified for the post. Even senators have pointed that out.
Yes.
But not just in terms of qualifications. Does this have an effect on the Supreme Court as a whole, given that she did not, number one, decline the nomination, she was the most vocal against Sereno, and she technically was the first justice to speak out against a sitting Chief Justice? In other words, it was unheard of in the past.
Yes. If you mean internally, among the justices themselves, if you recall, they restored this tradition of having a poll among themselves, no? Who to nominate for the next Chief Justice. And it turned out the justices themselves, they had Justice De Castro as the leading contender for the position of Chief Justice. So I guess they like her.
You mean after Sereno?
Yes, after Sereno.
Okay, go on.
Yeah, because the Chief Justice, the acting Chief Justice, is supposed to be also casting his vote in the JBC. So the justices among themselves made their intentions known to the one representing them in the JBC.
Okay. And why do you think would they all vote for Terestita De Castro other than, for example, themselves? Why her? Based on your experience.
Well, if you recall the voting in the co-warranto, it was 8-6. So the majority actually was with that certain legal position that Justice Sereno should be ousted.
Yes.
So
then it didn't have to be De Castro. They could have voted for others who also actually moved for the co-warranto. But they chose her in their internal poll.
I guess it's also in respect of seniority in the rotation. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Now, in terms of strategy, is there something that we aren't seeing? Mm-hmm. Is President Duterte actually acting wisely on this? Because come October, the next five senior justices would then automatically be nominated. In other words, there will be more choices for the president.
Well, nomination is different from acceptance of the nomination. And I think the president at this time is thinking he can have at least a little more time to think about the more permanent Chief Justice, because if he subsequently appoints someone who would serve for at least a year, that person can actually be right in the middle of the storm when very important decisions in the court are going to be issued. Mm-mm. For instance, the withdrawal of the Philippines from the International Criminal Court.
But is this good, attorney? In other words, the practice of the revolving door, we've seen it in the PNP, we've seen it in the AFP. One of the reasons that former President Aquino chose Sereno, technically, was he was hoping that you'd have a chief justice long enough to serve so that it would set a new direction for the Supreme Court. In a direction and in a way, you know, change policies that would last for years. It doesn't this politicize the Supreme Court in any way?
I'm really not sure about that, because if you look at the composition of the court now, many of them are actually senior in years already. So if you think about, for instance, Justice Peralta, Justice Bersamin, or even Justice Carpio, they are more or less retiring in the next year or so, or more than a year after this. So if you would choose even among the senior justices, you really have to contend with people who are retiring the next few months or the next year.
So, as president of the IPP, you believe that it is but right and fair to appoint a senior justice, even if they are retiring soon?
Well, I'd have to, all things considered, on all things being equal, I think the practice of seniority in appointments is a very sound practice, because it somehow, as I said, it creates a certain predictability in the appointment, so that the jockeying, etc., the quarreling prior to the appointment would be avoided. Of course, it's not in the Constitution. No? Mm-hmm. It's the president's given leeway among the nominees, but if in the past years or in those administrations where seniority was more or less recognized, there would no longer be questions on the motivations of the president appointing them, because, of course, he recognized seniority, and the political considerations were somehow accorded less attention.
Yeah, but then isn't this also unfair for Terestita De Castro? Because even if she is qualified, she's one of the most senior, you can have ordinary citizens thinking that, you know what, this was just a reward. In other words, it's a minus for her.
Yes.
Because then you're not looking at her track record, the decision she's made, how hard she works. The only thing an ordinary person could be thinking is, well, because, tinira niya si Sereno, ayan, it was a reward.
Yes. You cannot help thinking that. In fact, if you analyze the events, it was a coup d'etat, no? Paving the way for the assumption of a justice who worked for the removal of then Chief Justice Sereno. So the IBP at the time, our board, really insisted that the co-warranto proceedings were null and void, and therefore should not have been entertained by a court that would decide eventually and cast their votes on who to favor to be Chief Justice.
Yeah, yeah.
So it certainly is something that strains the limits of credulity on you. How can you possibly benefit from a position, from a vacancy that you helped create?
Yeah.